All right, so this is the headline is Pete Buttigieg loves God, beer, and his electric Mustang. And I got to say, it's just the timing of all this, because, you know, it's been, as we've covered on the show, it's been a rough 2023 in the press for Pete Buttigieg. And to come across with, like, this absolute suck job that I'm about to tell you is, it's just like, they're like, okay, we need the softest media target for Pete Buttigieg. And it's the liberal creationist lady.
Yeah, Pete Buttigieg, wouldn't you know it, like, every problem, every bad thing that happens, you know, it's something related to transportation. And even, I love the thing people try to do to bail him out, where they're like, oh, that's actually not the Department of Transportation's jobs. I don't care. I don't give a shit.
The subhead to the article is, sure, the U.S. Secretary of Transportation has thoughts on building bridges, but infrastructure occupies just a sliver of his voluminous mind.
That's good to know.
Wait a minute. Isn't this a huge waste of talent, then, to have him dicking around in a job that he can't do anything in?
Yeah. Shouldn't he be like the secretary of polymaths, then? Like, what the fuck is he doing at transportation?
Innovation czar?
Yeah. I want, like, a big fat guy from Cook County who's been a bridge supervisor for 90 years instead of this fucking... guy who does Rubik's cubes all day. I don't know.
Yeah, we should not have him, like, just standing around a train derailment, like, putting his shrugging. He should be, like, in a vat with the other precogs trying to save humanity.
It's not Pete Buttigieg's fault that the stadium collapsed. So the first paragraph of this piece is one sentence. And I'm just going to read it to you now. The curious mind of Pete Buttigieg holds much of its functionality in reserve. Even as he discusses... that was the first sentence. This next one is just one long sentence. Even as he discusses railroads and airlines down to pointless data that is his current stock and trade, the U.S. Secretary of Transportation comes off like a Mensa black card holder who might have a secret go habit or a three-second Rubik's Cube solution or a knack for supplying off the top of his head the day of the week for a random date in 1404, along with a non-condescending history of the Julian and Gregorian calendars.
So he keeps, while he's talking about one subject, you can easily see him knowing about other ones. So, like, anybody, really, like any adult.
I want to know what you get with the Mensa black card. What is
a Mensa black card?
Yeah, like, what do you get with the black card?
Do I get rewards points for that?
You earn brain points for every JetBlue flight. You can hang out in the special JetBlue Brain Lounge
with the other brainiacs, exchanging high-level thoughts telepathically, not even having to talk.
Yeah, it is. It's just nonstop in there. It's like a bunch of Snapple facts, you know, just flying through the air.
But was it along with a non-condescending history of the Julian and Gregorian calendars? Has Virginia been talking to people who, like, pretentiously and condescendingly explained to her the Gregorian calendar? What the fuck does that even sound like?
It's awful. Oh. they use a little baby voice when they're doing it. Humiliating.
It was at the Council of Twent.
As Secretary Buttigieg and I talked in his underfurnished corner office. Oh, how fucking humble of him. As Secretary Buttigieg and I talked in his underfurnished corner office one afternoon in early spring, I slowly became aware that his cabinet job requires only a modest portion of his cognitive powers.
Seriously. If you're like, damn, this transportation secretary job is just running me ragged. It's like, okay, we don't have a lot of horsepower here under the hood.
Yeah, he's so different from the last, you know, 10 transportation secretaries who... You know, the job was so taxing on them, their brain overheated and they died. There have been 500 transportation secretaries. No one can survive.
Except he, like...
Yeah, doesn't it? Don't they remember when Ray LaHood's head exploded like scanners at the State of the Union?
Yeah. Every other transportation secretary, they have the thing from Johnny Mnemonic where they run out of space in their brain.
Overdrawn at the memory bank.
I need to get online.
I mean, whereas she's writing about Pete Buttigieg like he's fucking Lieutenant Barclay in that episode of Star Trek The Next Generation where like he encounters some alien probe that accelerates his mind's capacity by like exponential degrees until he's just like a god. Just sitting, like, looking at things and, like, lights lighting up different things. Tell me about the Gregorian calendar, Lieutenant Barclay. I slowly became aware that his cabinet job requires only a modest portion of his cognitive powers. Other mental facilities, no kidding, are apportioned to the Iliad, Puritan historiography, and Nausgaard Spring, though not in the original Norwegian. Slacker. Fortunately, he was willing to devote yet another apse in his cathedral mind to making his ideas about three mighty themes, neoliberalism, masculinity, and Christianity, intelligible to me. How fucking generous
I feel,
of him.
Wow.
In the cathedral, like, apse, in the apse in his cathedral mind. Like, I understand that this is supposed to be a puff piece, but, like, this is fucking embarrassing if you're Pete Buttigieg. Like,
it's embarrassing if you're Virginia. I mean, those people who explained the Gregorian calendar to her did a number on her fucking self-esteem because it just like her description of him is like he knows two things that you learn in AP sophomore modern European history and is reading a book. He, you know, was so gracious to tell me without overloading my pathetic aunt brain. Virginia, believe in yourself. You're more impressive than Pete. You're a liberal creationist. You wrote the funniest, like, Trump-Russia stuff ever. You are the best at it. You wrote so much funny stuff. You know, you're I don't care about Alpha Bank. You, the stuff you wrote, awesome. You're crazy in a great way. You're a true artist. This guy is not impressive. You're impressive. Believe in yourself.
Well, yeah. I mean, just the idea that, like, it's so impressive that he could, like, I mean, like, just think how high your IQ has to be to have an opinion on neoliberalism. Well, shit, if that's the case, the whole podcast industry needs to fucking wrap it up right now. Because yeah. I got news for you, Virginia. You don't have to be very smart to have an opinion on any of these things.
All the things she's describing Pete is doing, like, that are amazing. Literally all things. Like, I know about neoliberalism. I've read, you know, dozens of Nausgaard books. I've read way more than he has. And I barely have cognition. I failed a mirror test. I've attacked every mirror I've ever fucking seen in my life.
It says here, because Buttigieg at 41 is an old millennial, because as a Rhodes Scholar at Oxford, he got a first in PPE, philosophy, politics, and economics. The trademark degree for Labour Party elites of the Tony Blair era, because he worked optimizing grocery store pricing at McKinsey. I love that. I love that little term of art, optimizing grocery store pricing. Like, for who? Yeah. Like, who are these prices being optimized on behalf of the consumer?
Virginia really just padding over, just sweeping it under the rug. The whole bread scam.
This is the bread scam boat. Oh, it says here, because he joined the Navy in hopes of promoting democracy in Afghanistan, because he got gay married to his partner Chasen in 2018, and because as mayor of South Bend, Indiana, he agitated to bring hipster entrepreneurism and high-tech investment to his Rust Belt hometown. I had to ask him about neoliberalism, the happy idea that consumer markets and liberal democracy will always expand and will always expand together. I was also fascinated by the way that Buttigieg, who has long described himself as obsessed with technology and data, has responded to the gendering of tech, especially green tech, by fearsome culture warriors, including Marjorie Taylor Greene.
What did she mean, the gendering of tech?
In the interview, like, she just, like, uses kind of like the Josh Holloway, Tucker Carlson, like, masculinity panic thing to just be like, oh, but you drive an electric Mustang. Like, that's not faggy. And then he's like, no, not at all. It's actually quite cool to drive a powerful car. It says here, Buttigieg, whose father was a renowned Marxist scholar, was himself a devotee of Senator Bernie Sanders as a young man. He now recognizes that the persistence of far-right ideology with its masculinist and anti-democratic preoccupations is part of the reason that neoliberalism has come undone. Not everyone, it seems, even wants a rising standard of living if it means they have to accept the greater enfranchisement of undesirables, including, of course, women, poor people, black people, and the usual demons in the sights of the world's Ted Cruz's and Tucker Carlson's. He also talked about his faith. Lefties these days are said to be less religious than right-wing evangelicals, but between Buttigieg, whose Episcopalianism grounds his decision-making, and his boss, President Joe Biden, whose robust Catholicism drives his sincere effort to revive America's soul, perhaps a religious left is rising again. I love the idea that she's like, his sincere, like, you know, the vanguard of like a great awakening and religious faith in this country is going to come from a fucking Episcopalian. I was raised Episcopalian. It's a religion for people who don't believe in God or religion.
Yeah. It is.
Yeah.
Oh my God. Episcopalianism makes Reformed Judaism look like snake handling. It is just, it's fucking nothing.
It is the Zima of religions.
Yeah, it is just nothing. Absolutely nothing. What so freaks me, there's nothing more terrifying to me than a Maltese Episcopalian. You're supposed to be seeing the Virgin Mary in like olive dip.
Yeah.
What the fuck are you doing? You're supposed to be crying all the time.
Yeah,
cut it out. You're not Herbert Walker Bush.
Yeah, it wasn't a fucking tea and crumpets that drove the Turks out of Valletta, buddy.
Yeah,
I'm seeing the Blessed Virgin in this white wine stain.
We need to sit Pete down and make him watch Jonah Baker's Final Justice to like
get
in touch with his roots.
Or the Steven Seagal movie General Commander, in which much of which takes place on Malta, and one of the bad guys is a Maltese, an Italian Maltese gangster. Do you remember that?
Yeah,
oh, yeah.
You remember the scene in that movie where they introduce the villain and they're having dinner at a restaurant and they just bring in the food and he just goes, ah, pasta, pasta. Basta. And then they slit a guy's throat and like is just gouts of blood, just fill some, you know, plate of gnocchi or something.
This is off topic, but that was a Seagal movie where he goes, I've been coming here to Asia for many years now.
Yep.
Right.
That was the one.
Greatest line of all time.
And it also had like the most, like the, remember the bafflingly edited scene of people getting off a plane and they just keep getting back and you're like, it's like a clown car. You're like, wait, who's where? I don't understand what's going on here.
I rewatched the other day, Perfect Weapon. Greatest twist ending ever.
Oh my God, yes.
Oh yeah. They don't get better than that.
Avenge me, brother.
Eat your heart crying game.
They say how we live. They say that the breath we take when we die is like every breath we've ever lived. Avenge me, brother. I just want to read a little bit from the actual interview where Virginia asks him, what is neoliberalism and what happened to it? And he says, when it comes to neoliberalism, we got mugged by reality. That's one cheeky way to put it.
Okay.
He's so cheeky. And he goes, this is true with the realities of climate change. If you can't face that change, you might retreat to the default place of masculinity. Maybe that's why someone characterized electric vehicles as emasculating. I think it was Marjorie Taylor Greene. She says, are they not? And he says, to me, a car is a car. Actually, the electric truck has got more torque than a regular truck, and it'll tow just as well.
Argument one.
And then he talks about his love of the Burger King Impossible Whopper with bacon.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
It is pretty good, though. It is pretty good. But he has it with bacon? That's a smarter animal than a fucking... A pig is smarter than a cow, you asshole.
He says, you suck.
You don't know anything.
A lot of this discussion about masculinity doesn't have anything to do with the immediate function that's at stake. I'm thinking about burgers, right? He is an American, always thinking about burger.
Burger.
Always thinking about burger. It's another part of his voluminous mind as he's like, you know, as he's rotating shapes in his head and, you know, coming up with bread pricing strategies and airline ticket debacles. It's just, he's got room for Whopper in there.
Yeah, he's thinking about, you know, he's thinking about the Declaration of Independence, Spider-Man as a girl, and Whopper.
He says, I love a good cheeseburger. I hate a bad veggie burger. I like a good veggie burger. The Burger King Impossible Whopper with bacon is not a bad combo. How are we wasting this brilliant, this beautiful mind at the Secretary, the Department of Transportation?
Impossible Walker Whopper with bacon is the most ass backwards fucking thing I've ever heard. He really is Maltese. That is from the brain of the simple Knight of Malta.
I mean, I'm sorry, but Newt Gingrich got here much earlier, okay? When he correctly described the chicken wrap at McDonald's as at 200 calories as a dollar and pound bargain. That, the simple elegance of that statement compared to the blundering oafery of this mountebank.
Likewise, when it comes to driving, I mean, there's a very literal, physical, technical sense in which power is at stake when you drive. It feels good to be driving a vehicle with a lot of power. This is like deep thoughts, like John from Saturday Night Live. Pete Buttigieg's vroom, vroom. Deep thoughts, yeah.
Maybe in order to understand mankind, we have to look at the word itself, mankind. Basically, it's made up of two separate words, mank and eind. What do these words mean? It's a mystery, and that's why so is mankind.
The vehicle I get around DC in is a Mustang Mach-E. The fact that Ford made one of their first electric vehicles a Mustang is probably not an accident. It has three modes: whisper, engage, and unbridled. There are propulsion sound effects involved in the different modes to help you feel conscious of the power of the engine. Clearly, we have a chance to rewrite some of these easy gender tropes. My life happens to cut across them. I like drinking beer, lifting weights, splitting wood. I'm also gay, and I like playing piano.
Wood?
Wait a second. When is playing piano ever considered like, queer or something like, or just feminized or something like that? What the fuck?
I'm stuck at splitting wood.
Splitting wood.
I love splitting wood. Even people who need to do that, even if you're like some asshole who lives in a tent out in Montana, you don't like doing that.
Hey, it warms you twice.
Yeah.
It is comforting to me to know that this guy, he took his mind, his insanely powerful mind, and applied it to the questions of the moment, the crises that we face, and like went into the deepest mental realms to pull out. Well, what if we did Impossible Whoppers instead of meat whoppers, and what if we had an electric Mustang instead of a gas one?
Yeah, yeah,
that'll do it, I think.
But I like, it's like having the Impossible Whopper with bacon is like having an electric Mustang that has sound effects to like emulate a revving engine and horsepower.
It would be like an electric Mustang that still has like a coal rolling mechanism. It completely invalidates the point.
Well, no, you see, because cattle by far are the highest CO2 producing animals, so from the standpoint of climate change, it's much more important to replace the beef than the pork and the Whopper.
That, if he really thinks that, that's the fucking dumbest way to try to reduce climate change. That is the equivalent of just scooping a teaspoon out of the ocean. That's not why you do it. You do it because animals are friends, you asshole.
Well, I mean, I don't know. I looked into the Forward Party's platform on this, and they're saying get rid of the Whoppers, but like we need to bring in more of the Wendy's spicy chicken sandwich.
I mean, it's a great sandwich.
Wasn't Pete's thing like 6 months ago that he biked everywhere in D.C.?
Yeah,
it's like signaling everywhere.
Remember that.
I'm going to bike everywhere, but also I'm going to have a Mustang, but it's going to be electric and it's going to emit engine noises. It's all just hedging all the way down.
Listen to this, though. Virginia asked him, running Department of Transportation seems to suit you. Are there more ways the challenges of transportation speak to your spiritual side? He's got an answer for this. You ready? He says, there's just a lot in the scriptural tradition around journeys, around roads, right? The conversion of St. Paul happens on the road. I think if we're all nearer to our spiritual potential when we're on the move, something about movement, something about travel pulls us out of the routines that numb us to who we are, to what we're doing, to everything from our relationships with each other to our relationships with God. That's part of the reasons why so many important things in the Bible happen on highways.
What a fucking bat. What a shitty thought.
If
you think about it, since I'm Secretary of Transportation and I'm in charge of all the highways, I'm essentially the Pope.
Yeah. Wow, roads are really important in this text from thousands of years ago. It was one of the two things they had.
I personally never feel closer to God than when I'm in an airport. And by that, I mean, I'm close to killing myself and meeting him. He goes, and then journeys. They're also just marvels. Every flight is a marvel that pulls us out of that in the same way that religious rituals, holidays, liturgies are one kind of routine that pulls us out of another kind of routine. When you get on a plane, people buckle their seatbelt and listen to the flight attendant's very predictable pronouncements. It's routine. It's almost a ritual, right? And yet you're preparing to fly through the heavens. Life is a combination of drudgery and miracles. Part of what keeps me at home in the Episcopal faith is that it liturgically is rather conservative. I like that routine. This guy's like, I like hearing from the flight attendant every time. It's like you know, it's like
I always pay attention.
Yeah,
when
yeah.
They tell
first
me
of all,
where my seat back is.
First of all, nobody is fucking listening to that show anymore. The noise canceling headphones go on immediately as soon as the seatbelt comes on, and I am just like, oh yeah. Unless I'm sitting in an exit aisle and I have to do the robotic yes. If the plane crashes, will I help out? Sure. Yeah. I definitely will.
I could be on a flight and the flight attendant could be announcing just like, we're gonna do a blow by blow of passenger Felix Biedermann's worst sexual performances, and we actually have them on video and we're gonna show everyone. I wouldn't notice. Would not notice.
This is your captain speaking. We'll be making an unscheduled transfer in the Empire State Building. Hope to see you all in hell. I just feel like, whatever. I'm watching Wakanda Forever on this fucking TV in my chair.
Yeah,
I don't want to know about this shit.
I'm watching the sad Wolverine movie. I could care less. I love the rest of this is so great, though, because his him trying to get intellectual about flights. You know, a plane is so interesting because it's a place that you go to that takes you to a different place than you live. Or it can take you home. The fact that it could take you away from home and take you home gives it an almost metaphysical property.
It's, you know, it's
my
like,
Episcopalian beliefs, you know, they tell me that, you know, you can either be at home or you can be on vacation, but you can also take a work trip. And that's like both.
You know, everything is constantly coming into and going out of existence. And like airports and the flight experience is a lot like that. You know, trains are either staying on the track or falling off of them, spewing toxic chemicals into the groundwater of all of southeastern Ohio. And that's sort of like life in a lot of ways. You know, it's filled with water you can drink and water that will poison you and give you cancer. But it's just one of those little rituals that grounds us, really.
This is like...
He is so full of shit. These are like... these are the answers that like a clever student gives to like bullshit on like a test.
I feel like these are designed to give like this is designed to just give conservatives like just start brain hemorrhaging if they read this. They've really zeroed in on Pete. They hate Pete for like they hate him for like the dumbest reasons you can hate him. They're like, oh, I hate that Pete Buttigieg. Not because of McKinsey or he's doing a bad job. It's he took parental leave. Yeah, exactly. But this is going to make a Fox News guy shoot up a 24-hour fitness. This is just madness inducing if you're them. It's madness inducing for me.
It's madness inducing for me because I know I'll never be as intelligent as Pete Buttigieg.
Yeah, you'll never understand things as deeply as him.
I'll never make the connections that his sort of spry, like a gazelle on the African veldt, like popping from one topic to another in blessed, beautiful harmony. My mind will never be like that. It's like a hog just wallowing in shit.
I've only ever been able to have one thought in my head at a time for my entire life. And it's just really upsetting to find out that others are capable of multiple thoughts.
Usually I'm like, hungry, want Whopper, and my mind will never make the imaginative leap to neoliberalism and the crisis of masculinity. Pete Buttigieg should fucking join the Forward Party.
Honestly, yeah, that's what they need. I think that could really,
because he could add new directions.
Yeah,
because he could fill in a whole like three dimensions. He could
exactly.
Move
it's like forward. Hey, I got an idea. How about up?
Oh, yeah,
that's another direction you can go.
That's Pete and Jason's favorite movie, by the way. Oh, that was that first 20 minutes. They got the Kleenex, the waterworks are going to start early.
You do have to feel bad for him in some way, in that he would have been maybe not PM, but he would have been a great leader of a center right party in like Belgium.
Mm. Yep. Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. If you put him in one of those European countries, it's small, but it's just basically like a bank. Mm-hmm. It's like if Citigroup was a country, he would be thriving there. But no, he's got to be a dumb American. Mm. Tough break.
Yeah, too bad.
And they if he was in Switzerland or something, the fact that he's Maltese, instead of, you know, just being an embarrassing type of white person like it is in America, they would treat him like Obama. They'd be like,
you're the most ethnic man.
I never thought that we would have this day, but we have the Maltese chancellor. We truly have made great progress.
Yeah, Swiss Will I Am would like make a song about him.
I'm going to celebrate this by destroying 15 mosque minarets.
That does it for the voluminous mind of Pete Buttigieg, currently being wasted in the Department of Transportation.
Yeah, hugely inefficient use of resources here.
We got to get this guy off the bench. Got to get this guy off the bench. It's the second, if Biden wins a second term, man, he's got to get a promotion because he's going to be dynamite on the campaign trail. Bringing in all the votes from South Bend, all 50 of them.
I mean, honestly, though, if his brain really is that powerful, it's pretty clearly shown by now that it would be wasted in the presidency, considering who our last two presidents were. He's not going to be able to use that massive brain anyway. If the Trump and Biden level mental cognitive engagement is enough to be president, that's going to be a lot of unused horsepower.
One last little line from Virginia is when she was talking about his how like him and Biden are going to lead a spiritual reawakening of the left because he's an Episcopalian, and she described Biden's robust Catholicism.
It's robust.
It's big. Yeah, it's big. I mean, like
it's big and juicy.
His robust Catholicism.
Large. It's uncut Catholicism, they're calling it.
Well, best of luck to Pete.